Oh, wow, it spoke. That's the first time that's happened. Okay, so the other thing is, let me see here. Oh, okay. That's about all the announcements I have. Does anybody have any questions or comments on anything aside from assignment one we'll do after class? Okay, so you guys blew me away on the discussion this past week. I was really impressed with everybody's willingness to step up. And I'm assuming this was a step outside of our comfort zone with org theory for most of us. So I'm really impressed with everybody's willingness to step outside of that comfort zone, because you don't often see yourself having a theoretical conversation in a healthcare management class or in public health in general. It's an opportunity we don't often get. And so I think everybody's willingness to do that delighted me. And I want to reiterate the value of this, even though I feel like everybody kind of got it, is that it gives you an opportunity to think of how you can address the wicked problems you're going to encounter in a fashion that is oddly, it's going to be considered innovative, but really you're just looking to history and you're looking to the patterns of organizations that go beyond the typical scope of how an organization handles revenues and expenditures, right? So besides profit, what else is happening here? So I took the liberty of having a little glance at your, because I'm worried I won't have time to do very in-depth comments on every single person's comment, just because there were so many. So I actually did a little dabble and sample of everybody's comments, just to give us a little bit of an assortment of some of these lenses that everybody had a chance to review. This is by no means exhaustive, and this is by no means a reflection on capacity. It's just what I had time to grab, because overall everything I saw was really good. So please don't think that if I didn't mention yours, that it's not great. And if you want individual feedback on very specific elements, please let me know. Don't think I'm not trying to not give you feedback, but there are a lot of you, and I am dancing as fast as I can, because especially as an epidemiologist, I'm also dealing with a lot of COVID work that is sort of in addition to the research and service and admin activities that we do. So I may seem like I'm all over the place, but I'm trying to focus as much as I can for you guys, but don't think that I'm ignoring you or anything like that. Please don't ever feel that way. And if you do feel that way, tell me, please, don't hesitate. So with that, I'm going to show you what jumped out at me. Wait. I think I need to share a screen, don't I? Sorry. I do this every time. Okay, one of these times I'm going to be like super high speed and be like on it.
Dr. Schiaffino? I think someone's in the waiting room. I just got a text from somebody.
Oh, you did? I don't even see the waiting room now. Well, I'm going to just take out the waiting room.
Sorry, don't shoot the messenger.
No, you're good. I just took it off. So if we see any persons that are, we don't know, let me know. Because I've just opened it up to anybody that wants to do management and has the link. So who knows? Although I don't know why anybody would. Okay, thank you. I appreciate that heads up. Okie dokie. So can everybody see a little review screen? And I will post these slides for you. Can you see it? It's just the full screen. So I will post these slides after class. These aren't for like, these were just kind of a fun way for us to review and enjoy what we learned. Okay. So just to reiterate why we're doing this, and it's really why, to really understand how organizations behave in terms of these strategies they adopt, the structures they adopt or take part in, the processes, meaning how they organize their services, and then how they distribute their resources in different ways beyond that of profit. So not to forget. So I just grabbed a few that I saw that I really like kind of stood out either by a specific org, by topic area, or just some honorable mentions that I wanted to chat about, okay? So the first one that really stood out, and several of you discussed this. So those of you that did discuss this, I'm not gonna call you out by name, but I do want you to jump in so you can give us some background and context, was Theranos. I'm not gonna say that right, but this is such a great example of an organization that pretty much covers the gauntlet of lenses, but I thought it was such a great opportunity because one of you in particular mentioned a really neat aspect, and that was with respect to venture capital, right? So there was a huge amount of capital raised. And so when you're a new organization, you raise a lot of money so that you can be supported in whatever new innovation, right? So to help ensure a healthy birth, if you will, right? But we never really talked about that in class, did we? So I don't think that in particular that was discussed through a lens, but that also has its underpinnings in a specific theory. And I was just gonna ask if anybody wanted to take a stab at that. So I did talk about it here in terms of what happened. And these are three different theory lenses that I wanted to touch on. And all of you did touch on those, all of you that discussed Theranos, touched on most of these. So I wanted to know, those of you that did discuss it, if you wanted to pick and choose one of these three and talk a little bit about it. And I can name names if you want, but I hope you just jump in if you're not feeling too shy. And don't raise your hand, just jump in because I can't see.
Well, for impossible promises, I don't know if everyone knows the story of Theranos, but I think her name is Elizabeth Holmes. She's the founder. And she dropped out of Stanford, but she had a few Stanford professors sign off on her technology that she was, basically you could use just like a small amount of blood serum and it would run tons of different tests. And she set up like some of the impossible promises are like being able to go to Walgreens or CVS and have this small amount of blood do all these different tests. And it obviously didn't work out because the technology is just not there. And they tried to fake it like the technology was there. But yeah, the impossible promise of having your blood serum actually run a bunch of different tests, which there was no way of doing that. So that's one thing I was thinking about. And then also just one thing I wrote about in the comments was she like took on this persona of Steve Jobs and also kind of like lowered her voice. So she was trying to like project this whole thing. And that's part of the reason I think she raised all this capital. Like she had Stanford professors backing her up. And then she partnered with, I think, another like founder of another company. I can't quite remember, but anyway, impossible promises.
So what lens did we assign to that? What lens was a good explanation for this type of behavior, given that it wasn't a company that was experiencing a history and track record of sustainable profits and revenue for anybody to, you know, in the respect of a traditional revenue generating organization? I see somebody's mouth moving. I see several mouths moving.
Was that the resource dependency theory?
Okay. And how do we make that work? In what respect?
Because they're trying to do something so innovative and different from like the rest of what's currently out there that if they're able to produce this product that actually works, then essentially companies who want to opt into this option have no choice but to partner with them and like invest in them in order to have that product.
Okay. So remember, what's the motivation behind resource dependence theory?
The ability to like gain power.
Okay, power. So in the long term, we can definitely make that work with resource dependence, right? Because especially, and that's why I said we didn't talk a lot about the infusion of capital. It's definitely a construct of gaining capital, which means that if they're giving you money, they're not giving somebody else money, right? Investors. So you are securing that asset, that resource that somebody else is not. But what about this faking? And Ryan, you were mentioning a few of the things about the, and there is a certain element of sexism, by the way, in terms of the voice tone. Because I'm often construed as, let's listen to my voice tone, right? I have a very low voice. So that's not very feminine. But it's also very powerful, right? I can be very powerful and I sound angry all the time. But it's, you know, especially when I get excited about theory, it's like, is she angry? Is she excited? We don't know. But what else about faking, the faking part, right? If you want to repeat that, because that was really good. Or if somebody else wants to expand on that. If they caught
if someone else wants to talk, but I can if no one else wants to say anything.
I think a couple other lenses that were mentioned were decoupling. And then I brought up mimetic isomorphism because it was a new company. And so they needed to gain legitimacy somehow in order to attract all this capital. And so I think Elizabeth relied on copying Steve Jobs and other startups that were really successful in order to look legitimate in the absence of like regulation that, you know, was showing they were legitimate, or a history that was showing that they were legitimate. And she was trying to kind of fake it until she made it, but she never made it. So that would be like the decoupling.
I'm not gonna say anything because that was really good. What does everybody think? So did everybody get that in terms of legitimacy? So it was it was so many different types of pressures, right? Because I think she was very confident that they were going to figure out this technology, like sort of build the plane as they fly it. At the end of the day, I don't think somebody goes into business thinking that they're definitely not gonna be able to do it. I think she was like, we're gonna figure it out. Where was she from again? What university?
She was from Stanford, but I think originally from the East Coast.
So these are all like Stanford, emulating Steve Jobs. These are all examples of a desire for legitimacy, right? So these are all great ways to demonstrate her efforts at a legitimacy that normally you can understand. It makes sense, right? So, and loose couplings to a certain extent, yeah, you know, you're gonna get there. But the difference between where she was and where she wanted to be was so great that ultimately you either end up engaging in inappropriate business practices or you just don't get there, right? And that's where you have to be very careful as an organization. And what happened there was exactly what was it you, Alana, that just said that? I saw the square move and I was like,
sorry, wait. Yes, that was it.
but that's exactly what happened, right? And so the outcome was that the organization was found to not be fulfilling its practices. And what ended up happening? Was it a question of money? What ultimately did them in?
Well, there was no substantial outcome.
Okay, so why isn't Theranos existing right now?
They lied. They were caught really like lying and faking a lot of documentation, and they never ended up developing the technology that they would need in order to.
Which came to first, or the technology, or lack thereof? Which came first, the scandal or the technology? Meaning we lost legitimacy first. And once you lose legitimacy, everything else pretty much goes downhill. Because what if they had said, no, look, we did it. We got the technology. But everybody was like, forget it. You're a fraud. Then it makes it very difficult for anybody to re-up on your technology. Okay? Although, I mean, there's other things that you can do. But this is how important legitimacy is. It's so important. for your consumer, for your investor to believe in your product or believe in, and she was the product really. That's a whole other issue, which is that if one person is the product, that's also an issue, right? If the organization is the product, then that's usually a little better. But if it's a single individual, that tends to be also a bit problematic. Okay, all right. And I did want to mention too, just along this vein, with respect to resource dependence and legitimacy, was the Dick's Sporting Goods example. And a couple of you mentioned this, and I might be saying it wrong with Dick's and Sports Authority, with respect to the major move that they did. Who spoke about the bankruptcy filings and the buyout that Dick's did with Sports Authority?
That was me.
Can you talk a little bit about that for the class?
Yeah, it was, I think it was like 2013 or something. Sports Authority got into some really like big debt. So then they were trying to salvage their company, but then they just had to end up doing bankruptcy and they had to sell everything. So as they were filing, Dick's was announcing that they were opening even more stores. And then as Sports Authority was going into like an auction to sell off everything, Dick's just went in and like grabbed everything. I think, I can't remember the price, but it was like they bought everything for like $15 million or something like that. So they got like their brand name, their intellectual property, all their stores. So they just like took everything and then just grew even more.
And what's that a great example of?
The resource dependence theory.
Right, so it's bigger. If you want power, you get bigger. And they, and I actually wasn't even aware, I remember Sports Authority, but I forgot whatever happened to them. And so when you do that, when you can wipe out a brand like that, that's power, okay? So I did wanna note that one because I thought that was a really great example. So another topic that was discussed quite a lot, and all of you did a really great job, and this was across multiple organizations, was the general topic of diversification. And by the way, if you want to go back and forth or add something, please do jump in. But so the other topic was diversification. And I very briefly gave you a little bit on diversification because it is it's an organizational topic related much more to the cost of doing business and a strategic plan, a strategic decision an organization makes, usually in the face of either loss of revenue or threats from competitors, right? And so diversification is a lot harder than we think it is. So you don't just suddenly start like, it's not a question of, you know, you're selling hot dogs and you start adding mustard, right? That's not necessarily like diversification. That's just a little bit of options, right? This diversification is actually pretty hard. And I read on HBR somewhere, it's not necessarily about what your organization can do, but it's what it can do better. And that's kind of the hardest part about diversification, because you don't want to just diversify on whatever you can think of, right? Oh, look, we have all these extra napkins lying around. Let's start selling napkins in addition to, you know, plastic surgery, because that's not exactly the idea behind diversification. It's really about, what's the point? Are we losing something when we diversify? Because when you do something different, you're stopping doing something that you were doing to a certain extent, right? Unless you grow bigger and so on and so forth. So that's something to think about. And a lot of you had some really neat ideas. I grabbed one and several of you had some neat responses as well. So I thought I'd throw this out there and really think about what they might have done. So if you didn't have a chance to read about Fairmont, can the person that mentioned Fairmont Regional Medical Center sort of just give us a little bit of context about Fairmont and sort of what they did, which was unfortunately what you don't want to do. They did both of the things when usually you should just do one in the face of uncertainty and loss of revenue, right? So because you either... I'll let them start and then we'll keep going. Who was it that was talking about Fairmont?
I talked about it. Miranda.
Oh, well, there you are. Hi, Miranda. Do you mind just giving us a little bit of context and then kind of what, and I know I summarized it very vaguely, so if you can just talk a little bit about it.
Yeah, so basically what happened was the hospital was bought out because they were starting to lose their business and they're just trying to keep it alive for the community. So they ended up selling it to another organization. But what that organization did was basically, I saw it as like a domino effect where they cut the staff, which caused them to cut the surgeries, which caused them to not buy the resources that they needed, which then in the article I found, it basically said that nurses ended up buying supplies so that they could keep running because they were so low on certain services, which ultimately I saw was the reason to why the company had to shut down because they just didn't have the right resources and staff and everything else included.
Excellent. I mean, you can see what a problem that is. And that domino effect is a perfect way to describe that in terms of the loss of any revenue opportunities, right? So the expenses exceeded any revenues that the hospital may have been bringing in and the revenue streams, right? So you think about sources of revenue because you need different sources of revenue. And that and another reason for diversification is to bring in revenue. So when we think about theory, and I put up some ideas, what are some ways that Fairmont could have done things a little differently? Because they both cut staff and reduced services. Did anybody have, and some of the commenters had some good comments too on Miranda's main comment.
Seemed like, oh.
Please go ahead.
Oh, sorry. It seemed like what they had going for them was their staff. So that's like a pretty big resource. They could have, I don't know, reached out to neighboring communities or something to help generate more revenue to get supplies. Like, this seemed like they were really devoted and passionate. And so they had this commitment to the community that they didn't really take advantage of.
Excellent. And one thing we didn't really talk a lot about in terms of resource dependence theory is exactly what Jennifer's talking about, which is partnerships. So when in the face of environmental threats, one of the first and quickest ways is collectivity, right? Because the power of collective action, we've heard this cliche, but even if you can't buy something, you can also partner. And you see this a lot happening now with COVID responses, with organizations that don't have the channels of information, the channels of dissemination, the people channels. You're seeing a lot of partnerships that you normally may not have ever seen before, right? And that's exactly what they might have done, which was they had a very, very dedicated staff. So instead of cutting the same people that could have created that collective resource, because remember, human resource is a resource. I said technology is also people. So remember that when you think about, do you cut staff or do you reduce services? Always cut staff last. Last. That's your last resort. You never want to cut staff until we always think it's easier, but it isn't. It isn't. If the house is on fire, you cut off pieces of the house, but not the people. And a CEO told me that once. He said it much more elegantly, but I can't recall exactly. But anyway, and so partnerships would have allowed for a cross-training, cross-partnerships to send, you know, high-tier patients to different organizations and low tier patients to that organization, et cetera. Things like that. What's another one? And I threw it up there for contingency because I know contingency was a little more complex, but what else could they have done? So moving away from resource dependence partnerships, what's another thing that they might have done? Any guesses?
Maybe they could have, instead of cutting expenses, they could have found more revenue streams. So maybe there was like new surgeries that they could do that would generate more, more revenue, or maybe they could have renegotiated some contracts in order to gain more revenue.
Exactly. I didn't think about the renegotiated contract. That's a whole other opportunity. I was thinking about reorganization, right? To fit their current issues. Think about what happened to every service line with COVID. What have hospitals done with COVID right now during the spikes? Does anybody have a guess of what's happened with hospitals with COVID? Those of you that are in the field right now might have a comment.
Is it that they're like putting COVID patients specifically on one floor so that they're subtracting it from all the other places within the hospital?
And what's happening to all the other services?
They're being shorted to what's necessary.
That's not necessarily because of profit, right? So hospitals are losing money right now, but it's the response to the environment is what I'm talking about, right? That's exactly right.
Shifting to telemedicine also. And then
there you go.
Reorganizing all the residents and like pulling people in. So let's say you're a hematologist, but you were trained in internal medicine. So now you're working in the ICU. Type of thing.
And that also speaks to cross-training, even as a manager. I cannot emphasize the value in cross-training. Now, there's something to be said, right, with Weber and specialization, right? It's important, but there's also something to be said with cross-silo integration and cross-training. So a little bit of both. Span those boundaries. We'll learn about boundary spanning. All right. Let's keep moving because I'm going to use up the whole hour and it's not even about this. So I put up some papers about diffusion of innovation for you guys. And I wanted to tell you about diffusion of innovation because it's inspired by organizational theory, right? And I this is a little bit of a joke. Like diversification, only it's innovative. And I loved, so that was not just Google Health, but there was another one and I forgot to write it down. From Microsoft, one of you, was it you, Jenny, Vault?
Yeah. Health.
And I can't recall which one came first. Google Health is one of my favorite examples because I love Google, but man, that thing. So, and if you notice, I did, this is mean, I shouldn't say this, but I did, I said it. I said, so much promise, but such a failure, right? What happened? Oops, sorry, that was the whole slide. So what happened? What happened to Google Health? So who talked about Google Health? Can you tell us a little bit about what Google Health was?
Yeah, so I did Google Health. Also partly because I do love Google. So many good services. Love their email, but yeah. Oh, so, but yeah, part of the reason they said was they just really didn't coordinate with like physicians, pharmacists, people who are in, like insurance agents, to make sure like they established what their needs were and like made sure they were met. They kind of like went from like their tech perspective and thought and just ended up creating it. It really ended up just being kind of like a place to like hold your electronic health records, but it was really more of a focus for people like really into tech and like health junkies who want to see their medical records. So it just didn't end up really being beneficial to the physicians and insurance to like coordinate all the care. So kind of why it failed. People just weren't using it enough. They didn't really see the promise.
So does everybody understand why it was an issue of fit? The design of the technology, the demand and the consumer preferences, the capacity, the interest wasn't there, as well as the content, right? So Google Health failed to adapt to the right environment that and fit to the people that would use it. And in this case, it wasn't really the employees, it was a question of the users in terms of Google Health, right? So typically we don't think about it in terms of the consumer aspect for org theory, but when the product is entirely based on the user, we can consider it the consumer in this interpretation. But the promise I did wanted to cover because it had everything, right? Everything. Google was a legitimate organization in terms of technology. It was trustworthy, had one of the best spam filters when it first came out. I can't think of anything else to say good, but to give you an idea, right? And it had enough uptake that people would adopt it. And that's the innovation diffusion, right? It's the adoption. And so if you read any of the papers, I think it was from last week's module on diffusion, I'll try to talk a little bit more about it in terms of org change, but this is a really important one in terms of the timing. And there were a couple of honorable mentions that I wanted to hit upon. There was another one that was an app that came and went, and it was a great idea, but at the time the world just wasn't ready for mental health apps. Does anybody know whoever mentioned it might remember what I'm talking about?
Are you talking about Lantern?
I think so.
Okay, then that was mine then, I think.
That it closed in 2008. I mean, it was an early innovator.
Really, it was developed in 2013, and it was such a hands-off app in a sense where you were trying to figure out everything yourself. You're taking these tests to figure out which type of help you need, and you would then they would direct you to watch videos and how to improve yourself. So it was a very hands-off basis, and I think because of the timing and everything, it wasn't right. So it didn't last that long.
And that's another one is that, you know, if it's in part with diffusion of innovation, those of you that are interested in the framework, that it has to be adaptable to something that's similar. There has to be a similarness. So there's an ecological component to it, that there wasn't enough DNA of what was already known for it to survive, because it was almost too innovative. Which is fascinating because you think, well, why wouldn't you want that? Okay, and a few honorable mentions that I wanted to just throw out there was Doctors Medical Center was fantastic. Who did Doctors Medical Center?
I did right here.
Oh, okay. Why don't you tell us a little bit about Doctors Medical Center very quickly?
Sure, yeah. Doctors Medical Center, it used to be in, I believe, San Pablo, which is in the East Bay, California. And it was always kind of struggling throughout the years, like the funding. There are always things saying like I was going to go out of business. But they somehow managed to stay an independent hospital throughout, I can't remember how many years they were open. I think over 50 years they were open. And a lot of the staff there actually really liked it. Because it was just like community-based. It really like they felt like they were giving back to that community. And it was mostly Medi-Cal patients actually and low-income patients there. But anyway, they never decided to get backed by any other hospitals or join like a larger hospital chain. And eventually they had to like downsize and then they went out of business. And then because of that, like, it's just a huge issue for people trying to get care in the area, especially low income, because like there was one example I was reading of a couple that was, I think they're in their 70s and they have to take like a 3-hour bus to get to the next Medi-Cal accepting place in Martinez. And basically if they want, and they both have cancer, this couple, so it takes them all day just to like get there and back. So it's yeah, there's a lot of huge issues going on from that closure.
So what might have been missing? I mean, they clearly had the legitimacy, right, of the community and the trust. So what else was missing? And we kind of talked a little of a similar situation just now with Fairmont, right? Anybody else? What else might have been missing? Any guesses? Ryan kind of hit on it.
Ryan spoke about, you know, how it took 3 hours to just get to the center. So I think you have to also look into the logistics of transportation here.
You know, that's interesting you say that, because you're kind of talking about potentially diversifying, right? So satellite centers, but that also requires what?
More technology and capital.
Yeah, but those are all opportunities for diversification, which are revenue streams, and for partnerships as well. So these are all opportunities. So the goal is, I'm hoping you guys start to see the pattern, that it's not, think about different ways of addressing things. You know, a network of telehealth that takes Medi-Cal, only Medi-Cal. How cool would that be, you know? So another one that, and I'll do the last one because I want to start with strategic planning, but another one that was really good and I loved it was Purdue Pharma. And this has some inklings of Theranos, which is, Purdue Pharma was amazing, right? It was massive. It started as RDT. Very powerful, right? And who talked about Purdue Pharma? You did a really good job talking about how they just were massive and they gave incentives to doctors. So they were just like growing. Purdue Pharma produced what?
Oh, I talked about that. Yeah, they produced a new opiate called OxyContin, and they marketed it as like so much better than all the other opiates on the market. And they illegally advertised it as totally non-addictive, very safe. But then it turned out to actually be even more addictive, and it kind of kicked off the whole opioid epidemic that we're having right now. And they like paid off doctors to prescribe it more. And then they got hit with a bunch of federal and state lawsuits and eventually went bankrupt.
So what would we say, how did Purdue Pharma's story end? How could we say, what lens or what theory would help us best describe that? Because it certainly isn't power anymore. Guesses, thoughts? No guesses, no thoughts? How about legitimacy and the total loss thereof, right? Because at this point, you wouldn't buy anything from Purdue Pharma.
Well, I think what's interesting about the Purdue Pharma case is that the FDA actually approved it as non-addictive, which is sort of, you know, obviously as a pharmaceutical company, you want to make your product seem as attractive as possible. And then when you have a federal regulatory agency saying this is a non-addictive product, I mean, that, you know, sort of begs the question, you know, is the FDA, you know, sort of something that we need to look deeper into here?
You know, you have a wonderful potential topic in terms of our organizations from a theoretical lens as well in legitimacy. So if you could write your whole thesis on legitimacy and our regulatory agencies. Not that you should, but I would love that, because you raise a phenomenal question. You know, we have a lot of studies that were funded by the tobacco companies, studies that are funded by sugar industry, studies that are funded by corn. You know what I mean? So when the conflict of interest, have you guys talked about conflict of interest in any of your classes? A little bit, somewhat? Okay, well, we need to, but I'll try to inject some of that into our classes, because conflict of interest is so subtle and so not subtle at the same time, that's exactly what you're touching on, Jordan. It's such a great point, because, and look, we even matched today. That's how in sync we are. But it is such a critical element to consider, because it can certainly influence, I mean, a whole industry if you think about the Purdue Pharma story. And here's a few other ones that stood out for me. If you notice, it's a lot about power and money, and legitimacy. And power and money make sense, right? With a business, it's profit, right? But who would think that legitimacy would be such a big deal when it's so intangible and basically just a bunch of smoke and mirrors? But that's why I find it fascinating as a theory. Transaction cost is really about reading the fine print. And in your case, as managers, it's about very clear definitions and your contracts and your, for example, your job description. That's why you don't see it as much, because we've gotten really good about the legal aspects, right? Legalese, we've gotten much better about that. Not so much about legitimacy and not so much about obviously the money. So in case you're seeing a pattern there, that's why. All right, so what I would like for us to do is, you guys need a little tiny break because we're gonna jump into as much as we can. For this week and next week, you're doing strategic planning. So I'm gonna give you guys like a second to take a break, and then we're gonna jump into strategic planning, and I'll break you guys up into teams. Okay, so take five, and then when we come back, stop sharing. I'm gonna pause the... All right, so most of the abstract stuff we've done is done. Congratulations, you survived. But I wanted to kind of be in your brain as you go through, because like I said, I think for me, I think it's one of the most valuable tools because it just helps you think of things a little bit differently. At least that's my hope. So what we're gonna move into now is looking at that anatomy of the organization, and we're gonna move into governance. And so we're gonna start at the top and kind of work our way down the organization and the anatomy of the organization. And the first thing we're gonna start with is governance, because governance is kind of the brain of the organization, and it sets the direction of the organization itself. So we're gonna do that this week and next week. So we'll get as far as we can today and then finish up next week. And the readings, I don't think I'll add much for next week. So if you didn't finish all the readings for this week, please grab them, and then whatever I add for next week, which will probably just be about strategy and my buddy Porter. If you don't know who he is, you will now. And so let me pop these guys up. Oh, I gotta share again. Gosh, I always forget to do that. So, moving into governance and strategy, we're going to, and like I said, always with questions, just holler, because I can't really see your hands. And before I forget, one of the most, and I have it in my slides, but I'll forget anyway, so I'm just gonna get ahead of myself. One of the most important ways for you as a future healthcare leader and healthcare thinker is to stay informed of what's happening in the healthcare and health services delivery world. And so one easy way that I do this to this day is to subscribe to some of these press releases that come out about hospitals across the United States, because you kind of want to get an idea of what's happening it's actually a pretty small world, especially as hospitals consolidate and sadly close. Way back when I started my doctoral program, we had over 6,000 hospitals, right, in the United States, acute care. We're down to less than 5,000. So they're shrinking. The hospitals themselves are growing, and then the number of hospitals is shrinking. So one that I subscribe to is called Becker's Hospital Review, and they send you daily briefings, and I think you can change it to weekly briefings. But it's given, like, it gives you state COVID cases right now. It's giving you a lot of CEO information, strategic information. It also has job information. Those of you that are interested in looking at different types of job posting across the United States. But it's a really good way to kind of keep your finger on the pulse of what hospitals are up to. And I know that this course is hospital centric, but if you'll recall at the beginning of the course, I said that large firms drive the research and drive our information. And the largest firm in healthcare delivery is what? Hospitals, right? And so that's where most of our consistent and public information is in hospitals. it's building in FQHCs, it's building in long-term care facilities. So while I try to bridge and build in other facilities, we do have a hospital-centric lens. Most of my research is in hospitals, but like I said, I try to build some of the other elements in, but I want you guys to have the most information possible. Just don't forget about these other groups in terms of partnerships and whatnot. So in general, when we think about an organization, there's two pieces, two parts of it, right? When we think about the anatomy of the organization, there's a lot of elements within it. But when we think about governance and in terms of management, there's two parts. There's a strategic part and there's the operational part, right? So the think and the do. And that's a very general statement, obviously, because there's thinking at the operational level, a great deal of it. But the strategizing is what sets the tone, the pace, the direction, the vision, everything for the organization. It's a very important and critical piece because, and I hate this cliche, but it tends to be true, is it, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. And that doesn't mean that it's going to work. It doesn't mean that it's going to always be exactly what you plan, but it's always important to have a plan so that you can adapt, change it, break it, deviate, something. But it's always critical to have a baseline. And with, as with most strategies, pretty much if you've seen one, you've seen one. And so when I talk about strategy in this class, or the strategic element, we're talking about the governing board, so the board, and we're talking about the C-suite, right? So the executive level of what you're familiar with in the org chart. And usually you see the executive offices and the operational part in the org chart. I'm gonna show you both so you guys can get an idea of how everything kind of runs together. But overall, strategically, the governing board and to a certain extent, the executive offices have the legal responsibility for the organization. The primary legal and fiduciary duty, meaning the people that gave the money, is the board's problem. They're the ones that really have to answer for that, okay? And we'll get to operational in a minute. I'm not ignoring them. So let's start with the board, okay? So we're all somewhat familiar with boards, right? Board of directors, board of trustees. We've all heard of these to a certain extent, yes? Hopefully 641, okay. But really governance in general, any governance system, a community board, community advisors, is really, it's a system of making important decisions. That's a really good way to say, just how do we make important decisions that's kind of outside of the day-to-day? And this is really important because you want this system to be thinking about your overall system. Remember we talked about systems of systems and all of the complexities involved with that. And they help you think about why you're here. What are you gonna do with what you're here, your goals? What are the resources that you have? Capital financing, which is sort of the side projects that you only do sometimes because you have to raise side money for that, right? So budgets day-to-day finance. Capital financing is like a bigger investment. And then quality improvement, again, that's continuous day-to-day. And then planning for the future, which is always kind of funny because if you looked at my little meme or whatever, there's lots of those, by the way, if you Google that, it's hilarious. But really, it's a question about navigating the internal environment with the external and helping the organization manage as best it can all of those complexities, including profit, plus that motivation. That's the board. The board also manages that motivation. Is it fit? Is it power? Is it legitimacy? Those decisions are made by the board, or those pivots, if you will, right? Because it's not official. There's no official statement when we think about org theory or how it fits into this, that the board says, okay, everybody, we're gonna do fit. We're gonna do, our motivation is legitimacy. No, it's more of, this is what's happening to us. Here's how we need to respond. Those things occur at the governance board level, okay? So, oops, come on, Arrow. So some of the functions of the board, come on. Oi, there we go. There's multiple functions with multiple committees, but we're gonna discuss it as six overall functions. And then we're gonna talk about a few sub-functions, okay? So these are the six functions I'm gonna talk about, and we're gonna go through each one and give examples. We're not gonna get through all these today, so just FYI. By the way, I did put PDFs up of big slides and then note-taking slides, and I know some of you guys want a note-taking, but some of my images were disappearing with my my PowerPoint for some reason, so PDFs it is. So I'm sorry about that, those of you that wanna take notes on PowerPoints. Hopefully the note slides worked and you can take notes of these. So the first thing is that the first function we're gonna talk about is they appoint the CEO, okay? They also appoint the other C's, if you will, the additional executives. So the board is critical to selecting a good CEO. The CEO is not only the face of the organization, because how many of you know everybody on a certain board and versus how many of us know the CEO of an organization, right? So everybody knows who Steve Jobs was, right? Does everybody know who the board was when Steve Jobs was CEO? Did we even know that there was a board? Probably not, right? I mean, who did? But do you know what I mean? No, we don't know. We don't care, because who cares, right? The CEO is the only person that matters. For example, do we know who's the CEO of Tesla?
Yeah, Musk.
Who's on the board of Tesla?
We don't know.
Right? Just kidding. We don't know. Yeah. Well, we usually don't know, right? So does this kind of make sense? That's actually a good board. That they're not supposed to be public because they're not supposed to be easily influenced, et cetera, et cetera. The CEO, though, as you can see, is important in good ways and bad, but that's the CEO. And they also appoint additional executive staff, okay? Gosh. Sorry, I'm having all kinds of tech problems. And so the reason that I put this up here is this is the organizational chart with governance in it. And I wanted to do this specific org chart for you guys because I want you guys to see that the CEO kind of has two roles, right? Right here. Because they have a duty, right? A duty meaning they answer to not only the board, but also the hospital, which is a lot of different people, a lot of hats. So a board, and we know that board of directors and board of trustees is for-profit, nonprofit, right? If not, now you do. But this whole thing is the strategic piece of the organization, if you will. This is the part that you guys will probably have the most contact with, right? From here down. It's unlikely you'll have much contact with the board, say for your internships. And that's perfectly fine. But what I want you to know is how important the CEO is. And this is just a standard divisional design. But I want you to see that they have a dual role. They speak directly to the board. They're not necessarily a member of the board. And that's not a bad thing, that's a good thing, because they answer to the board, but they don't have a vote in the board because that's influential. So it's not always great if they're on the board. That does happen sometimes, you know, it's not against the law, but it's not a great idea. But this is how they fit into it. And this is the strategic executive level right here. And then you get into the operational, right? This is the piece, what I call the gray area, the transformation zone of power and decisions. I call this I think this is the most important translational piece, because when you first start out after you graduate, remember you're training for your career. You're not training for the first job you have, which will be like, we'll be down here somewhere as an analyst, right? You guys see all my ugly scribbles? I'm writing with a mouse, by the way, so it's not very pretty. But I want you thinking up here. So even if you're starting here, when you're doing your internships, I want you aiming for an internship that's gonna give you access to this spot. Because I want you to see decisions and activities occurring in this spot. So you can see how these people with so many years of experience are navigating that gray transition zone. Because it's really, really hard. Because it's that zone between what they observe, what's really happening, and the desired state, right? And they're making those decisions and trying to get the organization to that place, cognizant of where they are and what resources and limitations they have. So this is what I want you thinking about as you begin to prepare, because you're not gonna get here the minute you're out of the gate, but I want you to aim here for your explorations. And this is where you aim here for your, you know, ultimate career. You aim wherever you want. There's no limit as far as I'm concerned. So that's why I want you guys to think about long-term. I don't want you thinking about, oh, I don't need to know this because when I graduate, I don't care where you end up when you graduate. I want you thinking about where you want to be. That's why the executive summaries are probably making everybody have a headache, because I don't want you to think about what you're doing now. I want you to think about the future. And that's why everybody was like, why am I writing this like this? I've gotten so many emails. It's so sweet. But yeah, this is what I want you thinking about, this gray zone, okay? So is there any questions about this? I'm gonna erase this so we can clear. There we go. Okay, any questions about this? Just jump in because I can't see and I don't see chat. Okay, I'm gonna keep going then. All right, so about the CEO. Well, CEOs are kind of like unicorns, and yet they're totally abundant. So you can find them anywhere, but they're really hard to find and keep. Sorry, you can find them anywhere, but they're hard to keep. And there's actually a substantially high CEO turnover rate. We hit one of the highest turnover rates a couple of years ago, according to the ACHE. And if you don't know what the ACHE is, it's the American College of Healthcare Executives. If you're not a part of the SOL chapter here in San Diego, the San Diego Organization of Healthcare Leaders, you should absolutely join. They have a really good mentorship program, and they've done a really good job of adapting to the pandemic by going online. If anybody's a part of it, please reach out to everybody else and give them some info. I used to be on the board, but my research schedule has not permitted me to be in the last couple of years, so I probably, hopefully, get to join down the road. But our turnover rate in California has actually gotten a little better. So we're down in 2020 down to 14%. We were at 20% back in 2018, just FYI. But Delaware, for example, is at 40% in this last survey. So, I mean, it's a real variable. And there's a lot of reasons. Like I said, there's a lot of closures. It's a lot of mergers and acquisitions and a lot of retirements. So market's looking good for the next 5 to 10 years, guys. CEOs, way to go. All joking aside, another big issue though with executive leadership is the lack of succession planning. So there's a lot of things that strategic planning in organizations that strategic planners do really well. And there's a lot of things they do really badly. One is celebrating success, which we'll talk about down the road. The other one that's done really poorly is succession planning. So if you don't know what succession planning is, it's thinking about what's gonna happen when you leave. So if you don't think about what's happening when you leave, then you're already planning to have a huge gap in performance, huge gap in profits, a huge gap in everything. Because CEOs have a big influence on that. So that's a real issue, and it happens a lot in organizations. It's good money though.
Dr. S, yeah. Sorry, I have a question.
Yeah.
question. You said when you leave, so I didn't get that part. Does it mean like leave as in leave the designation as a CEO, or leave for work, or leave on a weekend?
The board, not the CEO. The board is responsible for succession planning.
Okay, thank you.
But the CEO would contribute to that. The CEO has to, you know, they put input. But the board does not do a good job. Because remember, the board is responsible for all of these things. That's a very good question. Compensation is not bad. It's actually quite ridiculous, actually, in most cases. And it exceeds 10 to 20 times the amount of the lowest paid employee, which there's been a lot of politics around that. And in some countries, they have actually put a ceiling on the executive compensation, which to a certain extent makes sense if you think about how many times the executive salary makes sense, especially for not-for-profits, right? Not-for-profits. And compensation is usually based on base pay plus performance plus perks. And keep in mind that MDs also get perks, and so do executive managers. So what's a successful CEO? Well, personally, there's not like a formula. And amazing. No comment on that. I'm gonna keep that one to myself. I'm gonna stop looking at these comments. Y'all are funny, I like you. So what does a good CEO do? Well, they're persistent, they're attentive to detail. And that's also why I want you to aim for that gray zone. I want you to see these folks in action. They're incredible. They're incredible because they have the capacity to engage in higher order thinking, these theoretical discussions that we talk about, and maintain a rapport and a boundary spanning or networking capacity that is critical to their roles. But they also are ferocious students of their craft. And one of the ones, and I usually highlight this in bold, they are avid readers. So every single one of you, I'm not giving you reading because I want you reading, but I want you reading what you're passionate about, what area you're interested in. And so far I've been gratified with the references that you bring into the discussions. But I want you guys to definitely reach out and just pursue your curiosity so that when I throw things at you and say, what the hell is she talking about? Go after it. Go after it with evidence, because that's the goal here. That's the goal. But they really focus and they drive the vision of the organization. So they don't worry about the day-to-day because they create an atmosphere of trust in their org that allows for the organization to believe in itself, right? So that they can leave that part to the operational side. A good CEO allows operations to operate. And, you know, they meet, they're like the king and queen of meetings, which I think I can never be a good CEO because of that. So we're doing just the CEO today and just the org chart today, because I want you guys to do one thing today, and that is to get into your groups. So in the last 4 or 5 minutes that we have, you have one task. And I'm gonna make the homework, the assignment to public, but, and it is to do an org chart, but we're not gonna fully do everything until next week, just because I want us to have plenty of time to do it. But your task is A, you need to write down your group, and B, you need to come up with your group theme song in 3 minutes. So at 2:15, we're gonna come back, because the first thing that a strategic planning group has is cohesion, your organizational representation, your motto, right? But don't come up with a motto or vision yet. You will, but first you just need a song. Can you guys do that for me? So I've assigned you to your, but you have to have this group next week. So write down the people. Okay, bye. Oh, shoot, I closed them. Open. Are you guys going to the rooms? Is it happening? Is it working? Crap. Oh yeah, it's working. Okay.
Dr. S, I'm still in the main session.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, for some reason. Me too.
I need to like a breakout room, but then it like sent me back.
Yeah, I entered a breakout room and then they pulled us back in.
Okay. Why?
I think if you go down to breakout rooms on the screen and then you can put, or you can choose join breakout room.
I have to join it?
Oh, I see it, I see it.
So each of us individually.
Oh,
we have to join it?
You're talking to everybody else.
Yeah, we can all do that.
Yeah, you all have to join the room. I can't. Yes, please join the rooms, guys. Is everybody good to join? Oh, you scared me. Okay, so as we wait for everybody to kind of make their way back in, don't forget who's in your group. I did take a snapshot of all the groups, so hopefully I'll get everybody. But please remember your group because that's who I'm gonna, next week you're gonna have to select your group and that's who you're gonna go with, okay? And I'll try to write them down because I did take a snapshot. For some reason, I'm going to save. So, the first thing you're going to do, because this is your strategic planning group, and usually in life, you guys are your board and your strategic planning group. Like this is your life group. And there's a lot of cohesion. You guys go to like a fancy resort for 2 days and strategic plan for 25 hours. We can't do that for so many reasons, namely because I would never have that kind of money to fund that. The SDSU just doesn't roll like that. And COVID. So let's just pretend it's COVID. So we get a song. So I'm gonna start with group, hang on, let me see. Group one, which is Ahmad, Gabriela, Jennifer, Jordan, and Priyanka. Can one of you guys please share your song with us? And you can tell us the title and we'll judge you, or you can play it for us. And we'll still judge you, but it'll be cooler. No pressure.
Wait, so if I play it on my Spotify, will it play through on the recording?
I think so.
Oh my God, okay, I'll do that.
Pick the same one.
No way. Yeah, so that was that. That was ours.
Okay, that's good. If you don't know that one, it is the classic Eye of the Tiger. I may or may not have choreographed that song in high school just to age myself. And I'll leave it at that. Okay, so group two, you guys are group one. Don't forget your group number. Group two, Elana, Mariam, Rosie, Ryan, and Taylor.
Okay, so This Will Be Our Song. Give me a second, you guys know it.
I've done my sentence, but committed no crime.
I've
got mistakes.
That's pretty good.
I've made a few.
But thanks for it.
Oh, that's good. I've had a karaoke night in this room. I feel it. Well done, group two. Dang. These organizations are going to compete. I sense it. Okay, group three, Jonathan, Miranda. Man, why is this font so tiny? Monica, Roberto, Talat.
Dr. S, we picked the same, coincidentally, we picked the same song that group one picked.
Well, you guys can either battle it out or change it or keep the same one or diversify. Like a smash up, they do smash. I'm just saying, something to think about. Dance battle. Oh, somebody dropped the gauntlet.
Well, I think we have to meet again, maybe briefly.
I will leave that to your board. I will leave that to that's a decision of the board, and I respect the wishes of the board. Room four, Brittany, Cami, Chelsea, Ruth, and Tarek. Did I say Tarek? Tarek?
It's Tarek.
Tarek, thank you.
Yep.
So my default is to say everything in Spanish because I feel like it makes me sound like less like I'm messing up your name. So I apologize in advance and always correct me. What's your song, y'all?
We chose Hotline Bling by Drake because we envisioned that we'll be getting a lot of calls because our business is gonna be Pop It.
I don't hear it. I'm trying to remember the melody.
I know we met Hotline Bling. I can only mean one thing.
I like it. Man, I already like this stuff a lot. Okay, who's next? A ver, Jenny, Melissa, Monica, Tiffany. Oh, I got both the Tiffany's in the same. Tiffany squared. A ver, what you got?
We thought we would throw it back, with some girl power, so. I'm gonna hit up my squad to do some dancing starting now. We got I'm Every Woman by Whitney Houston.
Ah! Yes! Man. Okay. And then last but not least, hold it. I need. Emily, Crystal, Sarah, Shivani.
Yeah, so we did Good As Hell by Lizzo because also girl power, and it's one of her more PG songs. So here.
Like good sound on Zoom. All right, you guys, well done. I just realized once again, I kept you over, my apologies. Stay after for assignment questions, and I was recording this whole time. That's not good for anybody on YouTube. So recording stopped.